cell, different cell surface markers are expressed, and so we can kind of follow these through. And these are a couple things that we do understand. There are a lot. There's a lot still that we don't understand about T cell development, and so we're trying to learn about those and apply them to the clinic. But for the most part, we understand what's going on. We know that T cells will undergo, they'll differentiate their betas or gamma deltas, and that kind of plays a role into our ratios of alpha beta versus gamma delta T cells. And we'll talk about when that doesn't apply early in life, and some possible reasons for that. We also then these cells go from this double positive to, they go from a double negative to a double positive. Now they express both CD4 and CD8, and now they're going to undergo positive and negative selection. We'll talk about that. And they're going to, and this is where they're going to get specificity, and they're going to
get specificity.
So when they're double positive, now they're going to go through positive and negative selection, and they're going to get selected for those that recognize self-MHC, and so they're restricted to self-MHC. They're only going to respond to antigen if it's presented by self-MHC, and we'll talk about an experiment how they figured that out. And this is all things that have happened within our lifetimes. The people that have won the Nobel Prize for some of this stuff are still alive and kicking and giving presentations. So these are all things that we, you know, we're now in kind of our modern day of what we understand about T cells. So then they undergo a positive and negative selection, and this is going to happen in the thymic cortex, but then they go into the thymic medulla, and that's where they're going to undergo majorly negative selection to delete T cells that recognize self. And then once they have developed and selected to become single positive cells, then they will get a signal to go ahead and leave the thymus and go out to the periphery, and then they're going to go out to the periphery and become a mature cell over time and respond to stimuli differently. So the way they respond to stimuli in the thymus is going to be different than how they respond to stimuli as a mature cell. So in the thymus, if they get a signal, a strong signal, they're going to die, they're going to become deleted, go through negative selection. But then if they, once they become mature and leave the thymus, now any type of strong signal is going to induce proliferation, activation. So and this is still not 100% understood how they make that differentiation, how it's possible that genes, as they mature, certain genes are upregulated, other genes are downregulated, so some transcription factors are upregulated, some are downregulated, and therefore they have a different response. And so we'll talk about that as much as we know. So again, one of the early signals that differentiates a T cell from a B cell is going to be this notch. So notch ligand is expressed in the thymus. That's what makes it kind of special, that thymus, as opposed to the bone marrow. And that's why we develop mostly B cells in the bone marrow versus T cells in the thymus, is that notch signaling kind of indicates to them to start becoming a T cell, to drive differentiation, drive the recombination of the T cell receptor as opposed to a B cell receptor. And then they'll enter into that and become committed as T cells. Again, we know that there's multiple stages where things are starting to happen. Once they get into the double negative two, they become committed. So they are now decidedly going to become T cells. And then they will, in that double negative three, you get expression of a pre-T cell receptor, alpha, pre-T cell receptor alpha. So we've got beta. So again, here's where, bless you. similar to B cells, how you have your heavy chain and then you have a surrogate light chain. Here we have our heavy chain or our beta being expressed together with this surrogate invariant. They call it an invariant because it doesn't have the variations that the alpha is going to have. It's all one. And this doesn't play a role in stabilizing the T cell receptor so it can bind to antigen. It just plays a role in that alpha. If it binds to that pre-T cell alpha, if it binds to the beta, will actually start to signal to the cell to say, hey, this is a functional beta that I'm bound to, and it'll start signaling to the cell to go on to start proliferating. And so it'll send basically a signal, even though it's not bound to antigen. So this is kind of a process that allows the cell to move on to the double negative four stage, and we have B cells start to proliferate, and if you notice, they start to proliferate before they even recombine that alpha. So what you get, and this actually leads to more diversity as well, whereas if you have a functional beta, a beta that rearranged and was in frame and expressed a beta, and it's a stable beta and it's expressed, you'll get lots of clones that have that beta and they'll divide and then they'll rearrange the alpha. And so you'll get one beta, a lot of cells that have one beta, but they'll have a lot of different alphas. And so that also leads to more diversity in the T cell receptor repertoire. So if you get a successful beta, you're going to go and make multiple different. So you'll have one cell with one alpha, another cell with a different alpha, and they'll all have one beta. So that also, it leads to a little bit more diversity as well.
So they come out with even the alpha,
The alpha? Yeah, so they have the surrogate alpha, which is an invariant alpha. It doesn't have any type of variety. Whereas our alphas, like the light chain and the B cell, the light chain will recombine. You know, you've got B, J recombination, not BDJ, remember? Mm-hmm. So you've got the light chain, so BJ recombination, so our alpha will have BJ recombinations occurring. Mm-hmm. And so you'll get various different alphas that have different sequences. And then, so you'll have lots of cells that have, because the cells start to proliferate at that double negative three stage. They have a successful beta or a gamma delta. If they have a gamma delta, they move on. There's no need to recombine it anymore because they've already made a successful.
This one should be either is beta or delta, right?
Or gamma delta. So, because if, so, if you have a successful beta,
mm-hmm.
that beta will combine with a surrogate alpha, and it'll move on. It won't become a gamma delta. It'll move on and go through the process.
So
you don't have a successful beta, it's not going to go on to make alpha. It's going to go on and make the gamma and delta.
I saw the delta first. No.
Beta and then.
If you don't have successful beta.
Yes.
No successful beta. Then you go to gamma first.
Well, they're happening at the same time, but your chances of getting a successful beta are much more likely than getting a successful gamma and delta.
To my understanding, you have the hatching first.
You have what?
You have, you know, like whatever. You have a rearranged hatching first, right? Or whatever.
Heavy chain. Yeah.
So if you don't get a beta is heavy chain for majority, 95%. So if you don't get a successful beta, then what's the next step? You get an alpha or you get a delta?
Well, if you have a successful gamma and delta, so the gamma and deltas actually go through the process and at this stage.
It's a continuous. It is at the same time. Current.
Yeah. And so whichever one you get successful, you'll go on and become either an alpha, beta, or a gamma, delta, depending on which one is successfully.
So, I saw you said you always have a successful heavy chain, then you have whatever.
Well, that's how it happens with B cells. And that's how it happens with alpha, beta, but it doesn't happen that gamma, delta, or beta.
Same time.
Yeah, at least at this stage.
It's a one shot. If you get it, you get it.
Yeah.
If you don't get it,
and,
you die.
Yeah. If they don't get it, then they could go on to die. If they don't have a successful beta and they don't have a successful gamma delta, then they are going to be deleted.
Oh, okay. So you have two chances.
Yep. So, and in general, because you only have to have successful recombination for beta versus gamma delta, it's the odds are you're going to have more betas that are successful than gamma deltas because you have more events that need to be successfully recombined for gamma delta. And so in general, we have many more. As adults, we have many more alpha beta T cells than we do gamma delta, which is good because the alpha beta T cells, unlike the gamma deltas, are where we get a lot of our diversity. The gamma deltas are more invariant than the alpha betas. The gamma deltas behave a little bit more like the innate immune system in that they recognize certain factors that are associated with pathogens that doesn't give us the type of diversity we get for alpha betas. Now, this rule is kind of flipped early on in development. So when a child is born, first born for the first few days, it has more gamma deltas than alpha betas. And this isn't 100% understood how that occurs or even why, but it's possible that we've developed this as kind of a protective mechanism against either autoimmune disease early on in life. Also, if you think about it, as we're still developing and growing, there are certain genes, transcription factors, that are being expressed in development. We call them developmental factors that are not expressed in the adult. And so these developmental, let's say genes, these genes that are only made while you're developing, these genes get turned down when you're an adult because you don't need to make new organs or anything like that. And so those genes are actually oftentimes upregulated in tumors and in situations where you may want to induce an immune response. And so if you give a developing organism some time to develop where it's not developing T cells, it's not deleting T cells based on these developmental genes, you could theoretically induce a response against these genes that aren't normally expressed in the adult. So, and we do see this as the case in cancers where you get upregulation of developmental genes that aren't normally expressed, you actually will get T cell responses against those, even though they're self genes. You can induce, and you'll understand why that is, because in the thymus, we usually will get expression of normal genes in the thymus that will delete, make T cells that are specific for those genes. But if those genes that aren't expressed, we're not going to delete those T cells, and therefore they can get out to the periphery and recognize non-self antigens. So it's possible that we develop this kind of flipped, where we have mostly gamma deltas as opposed to alpha betas, either to protect the child from autoimmune disease or some other reason. But
so you said the gamma and the delta, they develop early in their lifetime. So that means they have less autoimmune disease for the
kid? It's possible that's a reason why we developed this mechanism to have mostly gamma deltas as opposed to alpha betas. Mm-hmm. It may also be that we don't start to develop alpha betas until we've developed them. We don't understand exactly what the mechanism that differentiates that. But
so, but if you have gamma beta, that means you just have overall, you recognize the pattern of the pathogen. So that means you have the kids, when they were small, they still have innate immunity,
yeah.
Right? So anyways, then with lifetime,
they start to get
their own immune,
And that's another reason why they, you know, they say that, like, for example, breastfeeding is important because you're getting what you're getting antibodies from breast milk. Those antibodies are adaptive, so you're kind of get a surrogate for giving an adaptive immune response.
So you agree with passive immunity, right?
So this early thymocyte development, you have your double negative, it associates that beta. So we're going to mostly focus on the alpha betas because those are what the majority of our T cells are. Those are also going to be more of our adaptive arm of the immune system. That so when you get this mature beta that is expressed successfully, then it will pair with a pre-T alpha chain. And this T alpha chain, it has a actually signaling motif. Unlike the our normal alpha chain, it will actually, once it binds to the TCR beta, it will signal. So it is constitutively going to signal to the cell now. And this signal is not telling the cell that it sees antigen, it's just telling the cell that it had a successful beta. Because that surrogate alpha is bound to the beta, it will now associate with CD3, so the whole TCR complex, and it will signal and it will stimulate. So all of these are CD3 molecules. These are different parts of the CD3 mechanism that will form the T cell receptor itself.
So this delta gamma, what's the difference between the TCR beta gamma? You see?
Specificity. Oh, these guys?
Yeah.
These are all just part of the CD3 complex that will associate, because if your alpha and beta, just like we talked about when we were talking about signaling,
yeah,
they don't have much intracellular signaling signals. They associate with the CD3 molecules. These CD3 molecules, once these will bind, will now associate and signal through their ITAMs and then send signals downstream. So they're all part of, just like it with B cells, you have a similar mechanism. These are your signaling molecules that associate with that receptor.
I understand that. No, my only thing is I understand, you know, in TCR, you have alpha, beta, you have delta, gamma. So that delta, gamma is irrelevant with whatever TCR, delta, gamma, right?
Well, gamma delta is also signaled through the T cell receptor mechanism as well. They just have different specificity than the alpha, beta. Don't worry about these. These aren't the gamma deltas that
we are talking about.
Yes.
Not hydrogen ions.
Okay, so these are CD3 molecules. These aren't T cell receptors. The T cell receptor per se, these are the CD3 molecules that associate with the T cell receptor. And here we have an alpha beta T cell receptor, or a pre alpha and a beta, as opposed to gamma delta, which is going to be a totally different receptor itself. It's still going to signal through CD3 if it binds to its cognate antigen or ligand, but it is it's going to be different. So you get signaling through the basically constitutive signaling. It tells the cell to it stimulates expression of the, so that now these double negatives are going to start to become double positives. They're going to express CD4 and CD8. They start to proliferate and stops additional beta chain rearrangements and of the other beta, because we have beta chains, one from mother and father, and so therefore you're only going to have one expressed. Once one successfully rearranges and expresses the beta, it's going to actually downregulate the rearrangement. It's going to, you're going to stop making RAG, for example, and so therefore your whole, the mechanism that causes rearrangement isn't going to be present anymore in the cell, and so you're not going to have further rearrangement. It also may block other factors in that complex so that you don't rearrange, and if you don't rearrange, you're not going to express the other beta, and so you have what's called allele exclusion. So you only get one beta, but once you have a successful beta, then it suppresses the rearrangement of that other beta. And then you go on and eventually will rearrange your alpha. That alpha will bind to the beta and And the signaling that is given through positive and negative selection is going to lead to different signals. Based, and we'll talk about how does the cell know this is a, how does it decide this is going to be positive selection, this is going to lead to me proliferating, to me being a successful T cell, becoming a mature T cell, as opposed to deleting this T cell because it sees self. And that's majorly dictated by the strength of the signal or the strength of the binding and the length of how long it binds to something. So these all these factors come into play. So you have your double positive thymic sites make up about 80% of thymic cells. So the majority of the cells in the thymus are of that double positive. So that's where they spend the most time, in that double positive state. This is where they're going to undergo positive selection, select thymocytes that have specificity for self-MHC molecules. Negative selection selects against thymocytes that have high affinity for self-MHC complexes. So you get a stage where you have positive and negative selection going on, and then most of the cells, they fail this, fail positive selection and fail to receive needed survival signals. So the great majority of our T cells, as they develop, are going to be deleted, undergo apoptosis, be removed by macrophages. And so we expend a lot of effort just trying to make T cells. And so you have your cortex and then your medulla. And so here we see that in the thymic cortex, you have a cortex with thymic epithelial cells that express lots of MHC class 1, lots of MHC class 2. And here's where you have both positive and negative selection occurring here. And here's where you have cells that are going to now get deleted. So if they don't bind to anything, this is kind of the Goldilocks zone. If you don't get the right signal, you die by neglect. If you get too strong a signal, you die. You have to get just the right signal, just the right amount of binding, so that you can have that specificity or that actually restriction to MHC, self-MHC. Then you will go on, become a single positive, either a CD4 or a CD8, enter traffic. You have upregulate chemokine receptors that will allow you to now migrate into the medulla. And this is where majorly negative selection occurs. And this is where, if you recognize self, you are deleted. And if you notice that the medullary thymic epithelial cells express this AIRE. This is a transcription factor that is kind of this prolific and transcription factor that basically allows everything to be transcribed. So you wouldn't think that normally a cell in the body is going to be a specific cell. An adult cell is going to express, your cell in the gut is going to express certain proteins, certain genes that a cell in the brain is not going to express. Kidney cells are going to express others. Pancreatic cells going to. So you have all these specialized cells in the body. The thymic epithelial cells are kind of prolific in that they will express pretty much, they turn on everything. And so they're going to make, and so the defects in this air expression factor, defects in those will lead to immunological disorders. You will not, you'll have autoimmune disease because you're not going to delete T cells that are specific for self. So if I don't express this AIR, or if I have a mutation in it, that's going to lead to prolific autoimmune disease because I'm not deleting T cells that are specific for self. They're going to get out to the periphery and respond to self. So that doesn't mean that all T cells are deleted that recognize self. A couple are still going to leak out. A couple are still going to sneak by and just not see that particular antigen that they have specificity
most likely to get autoimmune disease, and because you are not.
If you don't express it, you will have autoimmune disorders. Yeah.
Because you are not depleting the T cell with self.
Yeah. MS, so you're not presenting everything that you make in the body. So it's possible that that thymic epithelial cell isn't expressing neurotransmitter that a neuron is expressing, or it's possibly not going to make proteins that are being made in the gut that have form mucus layers, or so without that AIRE, you don't get expression of really tissue-specific proteins, and those proteins then aren't going to be made into little peptides and presented on the cell surface, and then you're going to get T cells that go out into the periphery and and they're going to have specificity for those things, because we have such a huge diversity of T cell receptors that chances are you're going to now have a T cell receptor that binds really strongly to that antigen bound to MHC, and then you get autoimmune disease.
That's a dendritic cell topic for the negative selection or negative.
So dendritic cells also play a role in picking up antigen, so they will actually phagocytose the MTEX and present antigen, endogenous antigen.
As far as like the antigen collection goes, like the dendritic cell, is it predominantly varied or is it single?
It's for antigens?
Yeah.
So antigen presentation is going to be varied in what they present. So you're going to have one T cell receptor, whereas MHCs, the molecules, are going to present the whole slew of endogenous antigens. There is a case, and when you're looking at T cell receptors, we have one. So this T cell has one T cell receptor that's only going to recognize one thing. This thymic epithelial cell has multiple MHC molecules that are going to present multiple different antigens, and the combination of the binding to those antigens is going to lead to whether that T cell becomes activated or not. And that binding isn't normally a single T cell receptor binding to a single MHC. It's usually a combination of those. Because if one thing that's different between T cells and B cells, antibodies, again, very strong affinities, strong binding, they bind to a protein. MHC molecules and T cell receptors, the binding to them, the affinity is much lower in scale, and you have to have a lot of them involved, at least more than one. Some people theorize that the binding is strong enough.
You have to have cells specify only CD4 and CD8 cells during this process, or if it specifies other cell types, like cytotoxic or even the regular targets.
So we are developing at this stage, majorly either there be cells deciding, am I going to become a CD4 or a CD8 cell? But there is some development of regulatory T cells at this stage. What drives a cell to become a regulatory cell is very well understood, and that's part of developing that peripheral tolerance as well. So if you do happen to get a T cell that has specificity to the cell, we're also producing regulatory T cells that will suppress that outlet periphery. So those are developing at this stage. Whether they rely on dendritic cells or whatever isn't very well understood. But the dendritic cells express both MHC class 1 and class 2, so they can be involved in both CD4 and CD8 development. Choosing between those is going to happen on either the MTEX or the dendritic cells pretty easily.
So this would be more popular if you have
restriction. So in the thymus, the experiment that showed that this is where this occurs is they took a mouse that was heterozygous for two different MHC molecules. So let's say it had MHCA and it had MHCB. And so they took that animal and they wiped out its immune system with radiation. So they radiated, all the T cells died. These are cells that are proliferating pretty rapidly when you radiate an animal. It's those cells that are dividing. So depending on the amount of radiation you give an animal, any cell that happens to be dividing is going to, that's why you lose your hair, because those cells are dividing. When you go through radiation or chemotherapy, it targets those cells that are undergoing division, and T cells happen to be one of those cells that get deleted. So you irradiate the mouse and delete his entire immune system, so you're starting from scratch, and then they would surgically take out a thymus from an A or a B strain of mouse that only have that MHC, that one allele of MHC, either A or B, and they would put it into the mouse that they irradiated. So this mouse, all through its body, still has MHC A and still has MHC B on the cells in the body. But in the thymus, it only has either A or B. And so when you do that, and
so they just gave to one. These mice, they only gave one A out B, right? Mm-hmm. They only gave one A.
Yeah.
You know, one mice with one A, one mice with one B.
Yeah. Okay. And so then when they take back, and so they allow the T cells to develop in that thymus that they transferred to the mouse. Then when they went back, the cells that were infected with the viral antigen, they were infected with the virus. So you had cells that expressed either A or B that they would put into the mouse that were infected with the virus. Only those that had the same MHC as what the thymus had were able to induce a response. And so that showed that it wasn't based on the antigen, because the antigen is the viral antigen, same virus in both cases. The difference was that only those that have the same MHC as the thymus were getting recognized. And so this is showing that you have your restriction. Not only do you have MHC restriction, but where the cells learn to become restricted to that specific MHC occurs in the thymus. So here's the experiment. They took an AB mouse, and they took spleen cells out. Okay, and then here they had the mouse that they thymectomy or radiation, so they either took out the thymus or they irradiated the mouse. And then they gave it graft, so they gave only the strain B thymus back.
They graft where? On the thymus?
You can graft the thymus where you took it, or you can sometimes put them on the kidney capsule. So I don't think you don't have to necessarily. Cells will traffic to it almost anywhere.
So actually, you just wipe out all the T cells in the body.
Yes.
So then you just put something.
So what? So yeah, and then so, or you don't have to wipe out all the T cells. You can thymectomize the mouse and also do it.
So you take out all the cells. That means that you take out T cells.
So that pretty much showed that this restriction is being, cells are becoming educated to be restricted to MHC in the thymus. So they either in the thymus they undergo positive or negative selection. These cells, thymic cells, epithelial cells express high levels of class 1 and class 2, which is important to drive that positive and negative selection. And then the T cells, over a period of up to 3 weeks, will sit and browse through possible self-peptide MHC complexes. And so they have one of three possible outcomes. Either T cell receptors can't bind to anything, cell dies by neglect. So there's no signaling occurring because there's no bonding, and so if they don't receive a signal through their TCR, if it doesn't get tickled, then those cells are going to atrophy and die. It can can bite too strongly. So negative selection deletion occurs. So you have both positive and negative selection occurring. And then negative selection would be, or positive selection would be if they bind just right. And this is where they acquire restriction to self-MHC molecules. And the great majority of those don't see any antigen, or don't see recognize self-MHC, and they'll die. Some of those will recognize self-MHC. They don't bind with very high affinity, but they do bind with some to some degree to self-MHC, and those go on to survive. That's about 2 to 5%. And then those that bind too strongly are deleted. Negative selection drives what's called central tolerance. So when we talk about tolerance, you'll hear the term central tolerance or peripheral tolerance. Central tolerance is the fact that we are deleting. We're trying to delete, before the T cells get out into the periphery, we're trying to delete T cells that are specific for self. This is part of our central tolerance. Those that leak out and have specificity to self are going to be dealt with peripherally with peripheral tolerance, and we'll talk about kind of what drives peripheral tolerance in a sec. So you get deletion, cells that bind too strongly, you get induction of apoptosis, again, not all tissue types are in the thymus. We don't have all tissues, but we do express this autoimmune regulator AIR protein, and it induces expression of many tissue-specific proteins in the thymic epithelial cells, and new T cells can be screened against these antigens safely in the thymus. There are some people that also theorize that antigens can be recycled through the thymus from the periphery via dendritic cells, and so even somehow they're either expressed by those thymic epithelial cells, or somehow they are brought via dendritic cells or via the lymphatic system to the thymus and are able to be presented. Yeah.
So MTEC are the cells, and then AIR is the protein that you're picking?
Yeah. So the MTECs are the cells. AIR is the transcription factor that is specifically made in these cells that allow them to kind of upregulate everything. It's kind of a permissive transcription factor that will just like turn everything on.
So there's an MTEC and a cortex. It's just
an episode of thymic epithelial cells that are either in the medulla or the cortex. Yep. And they're different in that those in the cortex express AIR and those in the cortex don't.
Which one?
So the ones in the medulla, the medullary thymic epithelial cells will make AIR on those in the cortex.
Oh, so MTEC make
an AIR. Yeah. So, negative selection, so other mechanisms of self-tolerance have been postulated. So one theory is that we delete, clonal deletion is one theory that if they bind too strongly, they're deleted. The other is that there's clonal arrest, where the theory that autoreactive T cells are prevented from maturing further. Clonal energy, autoreactive T cells are inactivated. Or clonal editing, second or third chances. So you induce, if you bind too strongly, you induce like you have what happens with B cells. If you don't get a successful binding, you would go through rearrangement again. Here, the theory is that maybe clonal editing also leads to a rearrangement of that if it binds too strongly. And these are still all theories that may have some examples, but in general, the great majority seem to be deleted, so that clonal deletion remains the best proven and most common method. So the great majority, if they bind strongly, it looks like they are probably deleted and undergo apoptosis.
So they don't put a...
Because if when you look at it, the great majority are being removed. If you delete macrophages from the thymus, then you don't get that type of removal. So macrophages play a huge role in just kind of helping to remove all those dead cells. So might have asked yourself the question, if you have positive selection, so cells that saw self to any certain degree, so we're the cells that go on into the medulla, they recognize self, right? They have to recognize self at least a little bit, not too strong, not too weak. So why are we not deleting these now when they go into medullary cortex, I mean the medullary thymic, into the medulla of the thymus? When we have negative selection occurring, why aren't these then deleted? So why don't we delete everything? Because we're selecting those that have specificity, and then we're removing those that have specificity. So how do we do that? And some theories are, we started to understand this based on the strength of the virus. So before we understood what was going on, people were developing mouse models to study what goes on in development, how do the cells decide. So they started making mice that only expressed one T cell receptor. So one way to do that is take a T cell receptor, take the gene that's already been rearranged, so you got a T cell receptor where rearrangement occurred, you take that, chop it out, and you will now put it into to a mouse embryo. And now that instead of that mouse embryo having multiple B, E's, and J's, it has a complete put together T cell receptor that's a successful rearrangement. So it starts with a successful rearrangement, and it will only make T cells of that T cell receptor. So these OT1s are mice that have a specific receptor that are specific for OPA or NA lysozyme, or it's probably OPA. So it's going to be a protein made in A's. So they're specific for this peptide, this antigen that's only made in A's. And so they have these mice. And then they have, they know the little chunk of peptide that they bind to, and they have two peptides. They have one that they bind to weakly and one that they bind to really strong. So they have a variation of the same peptide, that both are presented via the mouse's MHC molecule. And one binds really tightly to the T cell receptor, and the other binds really at a low affinity. And so they took these mice, and they looked at the developing, so they took the T cells that were developing, they took that pre-T cell, and they mixed them with the other thing that they had to make sure that they presented one versus the other antigen is they had, so these mice were really messed up. They only made one T cell receptor, and they knocked out TAP in them. So do you guys remember what TAP does? So it's part of the MHC class 1 antigen processing and presentation, and if we knock out TAP, we don't process antigen and load it onto MHC class 1. So you kind of look at our knocking out MHC class 1's whole mechanism of loading antigens in it. So if we knock out TAP, what you end up with is you end up with these kind of naked MHC class 1 molecules on the cell surface. And those can be, if you have the right size peptide, and you flood, so you have a dish with these cells in it, and you put in a peptide, a small, because again, MHC class 1 binds to small, kind of 8 to 10, somewhere around there. So small peptides. So if you have small peptides that you pipe it into the dish, they'll load up and stabilize those MHC class 1 molecules on the surface. So you can assure that all of those MHC 1 molecules are presenting that peptide that you put on there and not other cell peptides. Okay? So these mice, they knew that these were all. So because they only put the low affinity peptide in, or they only put the high affinity peptide in, they saw that when they did that.
Are they same kind? Or is the low affinity? Are they all same kind?
They're both from the hen egg, or the ovalbumin. They're both similar, but they vary in like one amino acid. And that one amino acid.
Which one is the low, high, is
the low? The low and high are two different peptides, but they're both have some specificity.
Same region, just some
yeah.
Mutant.
Yeah.
So with binding, maybe a
slight. Here it doesn't matter what they are, it just matters how well they bind to it. they are both from the hen egg, but one is an amino acid difference. And that one amino acid difference will cause the shape to change just enough to where it has some specificity, but it's low specificity. It's low. But they could have put anything in there. They could have just, they know that this peptide, when it's expressed via MHC, has low affinity for that T cell receptor, and the other one has high affinity. So really, it doesn't matter who is bound, it's just how strongly does it bind to that MHC. And they showed that those that bound really strong, that had high affinity, those T cells died. But if you had the low affinity one, those lived. Now they could also take this high affinity and really dilute it out, and those would live as well. And so
also the non-concentration.
So if they went way down in concentration, so very few were present on the cell surface, those cells would still go ahead and live.
So you have a series of values on how whatever, you know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you could find some dilution that was able to not delete cells.
So how your body...
And if you think of how that works, is, again, the affinity... We have affinity and avidity, right? So we can have this T cell receptor that fits really well to this antigen MHC complex, right? And so this is, let's see, high affinity. And if I have more of these, then I am increasing that the avidity. But then if I have fewer of these, now my avidity goes down. And so if I can dilute this out to where I only have maybe one being presented on each cell or just one, whereas this is naked and this is naked, even though this is high affinity, the strength of that binding is only based on one of these molecules. And so this really... plays a role in sometimes you can have, if it's a rare protein that's not expressed very highly, you can have T cells just didn't come across that in the thymus, and so they get out and are specific for it in the periphery. And that may be the case with like type 1 autoimmune disease, so type 1 diabetes, right? So here you have type 1 diabetes, and type 1 diabetes where you have T cell mediated, you have T cells that recognize insulin. And do we make a little bit of insulin or a lot of insulin? We make a lot of insulin. We have to make a lot of insulin. So the cells that make insulin, they make a lot of insulin. The thymic epithelial cells, they make a little bit of insulin because they're also making everybody else. And so some people have theorized the reason why type 1 diabetes develops is that you get T cells that escape negative selection because they don't see that antigen at a high enough level or at a high enough avidity. But then when they get out to the periphery, now they're seeing it at a much higher avidity because that's the major protein being made by those cells. And so those cells look like this. With, let's say this is the insulin protein. These cells are mostly producing are expressing or presenting that insulin peptide. Another thing they found with that also helps us to kind of understand what's going on is they found that, type 1 diabetes is actually induced by CD4s, people believe, because people who are HLA-DR, I believe it is 4, so that's a specific allele, have a higher incidence of type 1 diabetes. So if you have a certain haplotype, you are at higher risk for type 1 diabetes. And this is a class 2 MHC, class 2 molecule. And these guys, what they found was that MHC class 2 is a much more open molecule than MHC class 1. And MHC class 2 can actually bind to a larger chunk of insulin. And then this gets recycled, it gets chewed back into an insulin protein. So this epitope that's presented is different than the one that's presented endogenously. And so people have theorized that because there's not a lot of insulin being made in the thymus, you get a lot of presentation of via class 2 of this A epitope, but out in the periphery, you get a lot of presentation of a B epitope. Because you have one chunk of peptide that's presented in the periphery that's not presented in the thymus, then you're not deleting T cells that are specific for this, you're deleting T cells that are specific for this. And so you get T cells that leak out into the periphery that are specific for something that's being presented by the self-antigen that's being presented because that self-antigen is made in high amounts.
So that means the insulin B epitope is present more in the periphery.
Yeah, than it is in the thymus. Another thing that is true of this allele is that it binds more weakly. So when you look at the affinity for this alpha beta, this MHC class 1 molecule, its affinity for the invariant chain, II, is less than most other alleles. And so remember MHC class 2 presentation? What does invariant chain do? It blocks antigen presentation, right? But if the specificity for invariant chain is very low, you get some of these MHC molecules that don't associate with invariant chain because they don't bind very strongly to this. This allele doesn't bind as strongly to invariant chain. And so the other, some other early hypotheses that aren't even really much published on yet, or people haven't really done the experiments to figure out if this is really what's going on, theorize that the MHC molecule, because it doesn't associate, this allele doesn't associate as strongly with the invariant chain, can bind to certain endogenous epitopes that aren't, that basically can be presented. So you get a little bit more endogenous presentation.
You know, that you mean MHC2 bind?
Yeah, this is all MHC class 2. Yep. So that's just a side note. And that's just to say that this process isn't perfect, and you can kind of modulate it. So, how would you treat that? You might, if you did believe that insulin B epitope was the cause for inducing diabetes, you might say, hey, if we present that epitope in the thymus, we can delete T cells that are specific for that. So you could do some gene therapy to where you express that certain epitope in thymic epithelial cells. And so there are people that are looking at expressing, if they want to get rid of autoreactive cells, you can try and express antigens, peptides that are known to be targets for autoreactive cells in the thymus. So induce a negative selection. Self peptides produced in the thymus epithelial cells are unique. So one of the theories also is that the reason why. So one of the theories actually very well believed to be the case is that cells that bind weakly will go on and go through that. They'll go on to become T cells. If they bind too strong, they'll get deleted. So that's one theory. The other theory is that in the cortex, you get presentation of different antigens than you get presented in the medulla of the thymus. And so you may have cells that have some specificity for this MHC antigen, but those are different antigens that are presented in the cortex versus the medulla. So cell peptides produced in the they're unique and distinct from peptides made by other cells, and therefore thymocytes that are positively selected by this interaction wouldn't be negatively selected by later interactions because they wouldn't see the same peptide. There is some evidence, strangely enough, that this could be part of also one of the in the cortex are different than the antigens presented in the medulla. So, do these happen at the same time? So most likely negative selection can occur at various points in development, so both in the cortex and the medulla. Positive selection has to happen in the cortex because it drives expression of CCR7, which is the chemokine receptor that allows those cells to move to the medulla. So if you don't have positive selection occurring, those cells aren't going to move on to the medulla. And so we know that positive selection has to occur to kind of move on to the next stage of selection or the next area. As we say for most things in immunology, the situation is likely complex, but the medullary region appears to be very important for removing autoreactive T cells. So we say in the cortex, you have both positive and negative selection, and the medulla, you have mostly negative selection going on.
So,
primarily
in the ghost part of the
mm-hmm. So, again, and if I go back to.
Medulla,
if I go back to this picture here, so you have positive and negative selection happening in the cortex, and only negative selection occurring. Because once positive selection has occurred here, now those cells then upregulate the chemokine receptor and move to the medulla, and that's where now negative selection occurs, where if they bind to something to any extent, they are going to be deleted.
So for the next selection, they have found the right amount, right intensity. You want to know why are too strong, too not bind, they dead, right?
Yes. Is that about right? Several models have been proposed to explain lineage commitment. So at this stage, there's still double positive CD4s and CD8s. And because it's somewhat complex, some of it has to do with if it has a T cell receptor that's specific for an MHC class 1, when it's, if it has that positive selection, then CD4, so MHC class 2, again, remember CD4, so it's expressing CD4 and CD8, and so let's say that it has MHC class 2, CD4 will bind, and then it'll signal and tell the cell, hey, I engage, become, I want you to, in this case, it was MHC class 2, so,
class 1,
so CD8 engaged, and then you get, basically that cell decides, I'm going to be a CD8. I'm going to be a cytotoxic T cell. Whereas this guy back to class 2, and so CD4 engaged, and then it sent a signal saying, hey, become a CD4 T cell. So this does happen, and this is one of the models, but the other model is that this is a random event as to whether it's going to become a CD4 or CD8. And there's a random model in that it just randomly chooses CD4 or CD8, and then if it's able to bind during positive selection, it goes on to become a CD8 T cell, and if it doesn't bind during positive selection, so if it randomly decides to be a CD8 and it binds to MHC class 1, it'll go on to become a CD4, and if it goes, you know, so basically it. This model says that it's random, and it's actually a little bit of both. So it is complicated. In general, we have 1.5, the ratio of CD4s to CD8s is about 1.5 to 2, depending on.
1.5.
Yeah. So usually you'll have more CD4s than CD8s. That's why.
CD4,
so you have more CD4s, about 1.5 or two times as many CD4s as CD8s.
Oh.
Okay. So that's why you'll a lot of times they'll look if they're concerned that somebody might have HIV, those ratios will drop dramatically. So those ratios should be somewhere in that range, and that's one of the indicators that you do have HIV, is that ratio drops down now and your CD4 count goes down and your ratio CD4s to 8s becomes more like a 1-to-1, and that's usually, or even less, depending on the stage. So, both of the models, whether they bind to MHC class 1 or 2, or whether there's this kinetic signaling molecule model, are both kind of true, and it's a little more complicated than that. So I'm not really expecting people to know more than they know.
What do we need to know? We need to know the instructive models?
You need to know the two models, instructive or basically.
Stop.
Instructive, it means that if that TCR binds to MHC class 1, then you're going to get a CD8. If it binds to class 2, you're going to get a CD4. And then the stochastic model is that these happen randomly at a certain ratio.
Are we working the kinetic signaling model?
And then the kinetic signaling model is a little more complex, where it has a little bit to do with both, but it depends. And that's, this kind of explains why you may have more CD4s and 8, is because CD4, continual engagement of CD4 will lead to a CD4 as to a continuous signal. So the continuous signal leads to CD4, the disrupted signal leads to CD8. So this is the other kind of model. So double positive thymocytes, they can commit to becoming a CD4 or CD8 or an NKT cell. If they express an alternative TCR alpha strain, they can also become intraepithelial lymphocytes or regulatory T cells. And here's where they can also, so within the thymus, you're developing also regulatory cells. And the difference between a CD4 cell that's a regulatory cell versus a regular helper cell is the regulatory cell is going to suppress. So it has specificity for self-antigen, and it's going to go out into the periphery, and if there's an immune response, it sees self-antigen, it's going to try and suppress that peripheral response. And so we are also developing regulatory cells. It's not well understood how we develop them. About 5% of our CD4s out in the periphery are regulatory cells. These cells, again, play a huge role. If you don't have regulatory cells, you have huge autoimmune disease issues. So it's well known that the development of these regulatory T cells are kind of part of that peripheral tolerance. So signaling cues for alternative development is unclear. So it's unclear what drives those. It could be the strength of the signal. So Tregs may have stronger binds to self-antigen. If they bound to self-antigen, but they bound pretty strongly, maybe they'll become a Treg. Might be the length of the interaction they had, the amount of IL-2 in their area. So if you take T-cells, progenitor T-cells out of like cord blood, you can turn them into Tregs really easily by just slamming them with anti-CD3. That's an antibody that's going to signal through CD3 regardless of what's bound to the T-cell receptor and give them lots of IL-2. They'll become regulatory cells. So that kind of suggests that the amount of signal, if they get too strong a signal, they're going to say, hey, you're going to make a really good Treg. I'm going to turn you into the suppressive cell, not a helper cell, and I'm going to send you out and make sure that you're kind of trafficking around looking for immune responses to self-antigen that shouldn't be happening. So that's a possible kind of mechanism. So once those cells become single positive, they decide what they're going to be, then they start to mature. They upregulate the FOXO1 transcription factor, They upregulate IL-7 receptor, and these now will go out to the periphery. And these are recent thymic emigrants, and we know that they're recent thymic emigrants because they express IL-7. So that's one thing that you'll look at. If you've lost thymic activity, you'll have more IL-7 receptor positive cells. So it's just one of these things that you have these, and these aren't functionally mature. They have this small period of time where they're still kind of, they don't respond very well to antigen, and so they're kind of going out and kind of becoming mature cells that can respond differently to antigen than they did in the thymus, because in the thymus, they were going to get deleted if they saw antigen. Now that they're out the periphery, that's their job, is to look for antigen. If they see antigen in the right context, they become activated.
So, let me ask you a question. Mm-hmm. These RPEs, they express the IL-7?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Receptor. And that's all you need to know about those. And then you get mature cells. So regulatory cells, how do they work? So regulatory cells go out, they're CD4s, they recognize self-antigens, and they go out to the periphery, and they see self-antigen, they're going to suppress. So people have tried to use, so people have seen that tumor cells will induce regulatory cells, and they'll kind of say, hey, I'm self, so I'm gonna express cytokines that drive T, instead of T helper cells, I'm gonna induce some regulatory cells and create this really suppressive environment. Whereas in autoimmune disease now, that's where a lot of research is kind of driving, trying to get develop Tregs that recognize those same antigens, like for example, the B epitope. We're trying to develop regulatory T cells that recognize the B epitope so that they can go to that area where that B epitope is presented and suppress the immune response in that environment. And that's their job. Of regulatory C cells. So how do we know it's a regulatory T cell? It's CD4 positive. It's also CD25 positive. That's the receptor for IL-2, because they love IL-2. They need lots of IL-2.
So the Treg is a CD4?
It's a CD4 positive, CD25 positive, and FOXP3 positive. FOXP3 is the transcription factor. It's an essential transcription factor. So all Tregs will express FOXP3. And that's expressed intracellularly, so that is one of the difficulties when you're looking at Tregs in the periphery, is you have to actually punch holes in the cells to stain them for FOXP3 as opposed to CD4s on the cell surface, CD25, IL-2 receptors on the cell surface. So people who do research on Tregs, they have to kill the cells, and so that makes it difficult.
Treg is part of, you know, the part of the CD4.
Tregs are CD4s. They make up, in general, it varies, but anywhere from 5 to 10% of CD4s are going to be regulatory cells. In a given, actually, it could be even lower than 5. It could be between like 2.5 to 10% in a person. Those Tregs, they'll suppress. One, they express lots of IL-2 receptors, so they soak up. So they're really hog. They hog up all the IL-2. So if you have IL-2 is a really key cytokine for inducing immune response. And so if you have a lot of FOXP3, one of their mechanisms of creating a suppressive environment is they soak up all the IL-2 so it can't activate other T cells. So that's one of their mechanisms. The other mechanism is they kill. They'll directly kill other T cells. And so they will induce apoptosis of other T cells.
When you say other T cells, what?
So cytotoxic T cells. So let's say you have, the beta cells in the pancreas. So the cells that are producing insulin. If I have enough regulatory cells, and I have a helper cell that comes in and sees this insulin. Let's say I have a helper cell that recognizes this and starts to secrete IL-2. Well, those regulatory cells, if they recognize that as well, they're going to soak up IL-2, so they're going to make sure that they dampen any immune response against IL-2. They're also going to probably kill that cell, and they're going to also inhibit antigen-presenting cells, so they're going to also affect the ability of APCs to
for the so-called IL to suppress and whatever else.
No, it's very important so that any T cells that recognize self out in the periphery don't become autoreactive. So if you remove regulatory cells, you lose, you become very, you have a lot of autoreactive events occurring. But at the same time, let's say you have cancer and you want to induce an autoimmune response against cancer. They found that chemotherapy that targets T cells. So if you what happens when your computer's not working? Then you call IT. What do they tell you to do? Turn it off and turn it off, right? So we do the same thing with the immune system. We found that cancer cells, oftentimes chemotherapy or radiation therapy will actually lead to immune responses against the tumor and removal of the tumor. These are tumors that oftentimes grow fine in chemotherapeutic reagents. So in the cases where you gave chemotherapy and you saw the tumor go away, people were starting to say, well, how did that happen? Because I can grow this tumor in this chemotherapeutic reagent and it's fine. So why didn't this work? And they started to understand that it's because you wiped out the target wasn't the cancer, it was the immune cells. You wiped out all the suppressive immune environment and you've started from scratch and now you're able to induce an immune response against that cancer. So it's and in some cases T-regs are very important. They help to prevent autoimmune disease, but in some cases they can create a suppressive environment that doesn't allow you to remove these self cells like cancer cells. The other mechanism of peripheral tolerance is how cells see antigen. So you're going to get some T cells that go out, some CD8s. Let's say you got a CD8, it recognizes self antigen, it gets out into the periphery, but as long as it doesn't, if it sees antigen, here's my kidney cell. This is my kidney cell, and here's my CD8 cytotoxic T cell. Okay, and it sees an antigen. It got out. It got out, and it sees antigen on my kidney cell. It is actually, it's going to become stimulated, but it's going to get one signal. And if it doesn't get another signal through a co-stimulatory, so if it doesn't get stimulated through the co-stimulatory molecule, it is actually going to become, it is going to atrophy, or it's going to die. So if it sees self-antigen, it's going to actually kill the cell unless it sees it being presented by a professional antigen-presenting cell. And this is kind of the second mechanism of peripheral tolerance is, just because you have a T cell that's specific for self doesn't mean it's going to remove it. And this is where things like chronic inflammation, where viral infections can actually increase your risk of autoimmune diseases, because they are going to create an environment where antigen-presenting cells, inflammation is going to bring in antigen-presenting cells. Damage to tissue is going to bring in those antigen-presenting cells. They're going to present antigen, but they do have co-stimulatory molecules. So if you have a self-specific T cell that sees antigen on a professional antigen-presenting cell, and it's also presenting those co-stimulatory molecules, he goes ahead, and as long as he's getting two signals, he's getting that second signal, then he goes and he becomes activated. If he only gets the one signal, the first signal, he atrophies or he dies. So this, deletion. Okay, so you also, that's this peripheral mechanism tolerance is protects against autoreactive thymocytes based on that again, that co-stimulation by the professional antigen presenting cell. Okay, and then the last part of this is the different apoptosis and necrosis is really important because we don't want to induce inflammation. We don't want to induce immune responses just because we're killing cells. I mean, if that were the case, our thymus would, 95% of those T cells are being killed. They're being deleted. If we were to mount an immune response because of that death, then we would constantly be inflamed, have an inflamed thymus. So apoptosis is a more, it requires energy, it is a more directed breaking down of the cell where the actual cell mechanism will bleb, it will form, it will break down components in the cell, form membranes around it, and those membranes get taken up by macrophages or other cells that are phagocytic, and they're removed without inducing inflammation. And so, two major mechanisms. So, I'll kind of review this the next time, but go ahead and read through this because I'm not going to spend a whole lot of time on apoptosis. Apoptosis is how T cells really will kill cells because they will induce apoptosis. They usually do it through fast-pass ligand, but there are other ways to induce apoptosis. So what's happening when cells induce apoptosis are those 95% of your T cells become apoptotic is a more intrinsic mechanism. So it's not through fast-pass ligand. It's internal. So we'll talk about the different mechanisms of apoptosis and the molecules involved in it, but that's pretty much the end of this chapter, is just talking about induction of apoptosis.